A very good morning to all the participants. Today we have with us CA Karun Nagpal. He is an insolvency professional as well as a registered valuer, and he is practicing more in the field of insolvency professional. Today he'll be covering the topic on Ind AS 113 fair value measurement. He has an experience of over a decade in dealing with the US GAAP as well as the IFRS. So he was previously employed in HSBC, and he was looking after the foreign operations. Now, may I request Karunji to please start your presentation.
Thank you, Nitesh. Thank you. So, I'll start with straight away fair value measurement. I understand that most of the participants are already the registered valuer aspirants, so well aware of what registered valuer does and who is registered valuer, about the framework which recently came in. So I'm not talking about that. We will just start with the Ind AS 113. So Nitesh, can you please let me share my screen? Okay.
You can share it. I had made you co-host.
Can you see my screen?
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay. So fair value measurement in Ind AS 113. It started in India recently. However, in US, it was there even at the time of subprime crisis. In US, it is called FAS 157 Financial Accounting Standard. And it was not developed as such. And later on, it got eventually through a number of changes through ASU's accounting standard updates, there we call it as, and accounting standard codification, ASC 820, it got updated. So initially, there were only the level hierarchy, level 1, 2, and 3, and then later on, the need fell for additional disclosure about the level 3 items, and then eventually it got developed in US. However, in IFRS, they developed that this standard at one go. And Ind AS is the replica of IFRS, so there is not much difference in IFRS 13 and Ind AS 113. However, there are few differences in US FAS 157 and Ind AS or IFRS. So friends, let us start with, so I have the contents for today's session. We will talk about the fair value, the definition of fair value, scope of this accounting standard, what is included and what is excluded. Fair value measurement, how to measure the fair value and valuation premise, fair value hierarchy we will touch upon. Then we have the valuation approaches. So there are three approach: market, income and cost approach. We will talk about that. Valuation adjustment, once you arrived at the valuation, so we have to make certain adjustment to the value. So what all are those adjustments, we will talk about that. And finally, the disclosure. So fair value reporting disclosure and the COVID impact on the fair value reporting. So this is what we will talk about in today's session. So before that, let me introduce myself. I am a chartered accountant having 12 plus years of experience. I have worked with big multinational companies. I was into the financial reporting or financial consolidation domain and was taking care of the fair value. So I got an opportunity to start fair valuation sometime in 2010 when it was a very initial stage and there was only hierarchy, and later on through updates in US, because I work in US, primarily. So later on through updates, it got developed and emerged as a full-fledged accounting standard. Beside the valuation, I am also an insolvency professional and currently a partner with Synergy Insolvency Professional LLP, that is an IPE registered with IBBI. So let us, friends, start with the fair value measurement. So this standards Ind AS 113 define the fair value. So it give the broadly three parameters this Ind AS 113 is based on. The first one is it defined the fair value, then it established the framework for measuring the fair value, and it talks about the disclosure of fair value measurement. This standard is a general standard. It do not talk about that this particular asset or liability are to be valued or these are not to be valued. It is a general standards wherever any standard talks about fair valuation. So they have to come to this standard to know how to do the valuation. And it do not have overriding impact over other standards. For example, impairment. So under impairment, Ind AS 36, there is a separate criteria for determining for doing the valuation. So that will supersede Ind AS 113. So this standard broadly define fair value, establish the framework for measuring the fair value, and then disclosure required for the fair value measurement. So I'll show you the practical disclosure, how the companies disclose in their financial statements. This reporting is done practically. Then we have the definition. Ind AS 113 defines fair value as the price that would be received to sell an asset or pay to transfer a liability in an orderly transaction between market participant at a measurement date. So the price that would be received to sell an asset, that means it is based on the exit price notion. Why exit price? Why not the entry price? Because at initial recognition, we will recognize any asset or liability at the transaction price. That will be the entry price. But for subsequent measurement, at each reporting date, we have to fair value our asset and liability. And for that, we will use the exit price notion. What we will be able to fetch, what we will be able to get out of our asset or liability. The settlement price, we can say. And this should be in an orderly transaction. Orderly transaction means that should not be under any coercion or duress or any distress. So it should be freely available, freely tradable in the market. So free market transactions between the market participants should not be 101 transaction. It should be in the open market. We will talk about the market also. And it is date specific. Valuation is always date specific. Like in the balance sheet, when we say that the balances are as on date and next day balances may change. So similarly, fair valuation is as on date. What is true today may not be valid for tomorrow. Then friends, fair value is market based measurement, not an entity specific. Market based, I mean, it should be done by all the participant in the market. Suppose, for example, I am holding some share and that shares are listed on a stock exchange. So if I am holding that share, I will value those share based upon the price that are available in the market, and somebody else would also value that based on the market price. So our valuation will be same. So primarily the valuation would be based on the market. If the market data is not available, then we can move on to the our own inputs and own techniques. So we will start with the market-based measurement. Until and unless we do not find any market observable data, we will not use our internal data, internal models. And the entity shall measure the fair value using the assumption that market participants, so best economic interest we will take into account for measuring the fair value, and the risk assumption also, whatever. For example, I have some assets. I will not do any kind of deduction, or I will foresee that it will grow. I will not include any risk into that. Because that is, I am attached to it. I will value it at a higher price. So I have to measure in such a way that I should account for all the risk associated with that valuation. entity intention to hold an asset or to settle a liability or fulfill a liability is not relevant when measuring the fair value. So by this, I mean that, for example, I am having some securities, some debt securities, and I do not have intention to sell that security. I want to keep that security till the maturity, maybe by 2026, it is getting matured. So due to market sentiments or market fluctuation, maybe due to COVID, the prices fell down. So although my intention is to keep the security till maturity and market fluctuation will not hamper, because my intention is to keep that security, even then I will have to, while doing the fair valuation, I will have to consider the market sentiments. Let me take another example. In the financial statement, suppose I have classified, I am holding debt securities, and some of the securities I have classified as available for sale, and some other I have classified as held to maturity. So held to maturity means I will keep those security till the maturity, and available for sale means that as and when I find it profitable, I'll sell it in the market. So while doing the valuation, my intention do not matter here. Even for the available for sale security or HTM security, valuation will be the same. Then we have the exclusions. So what are excluded from the standard? Share-based payments, leases, because for leases we have a separate standard for share-based payments, inventories. Then impairment of assets, Ind AS 36, and disclosure also for employees' benefits and for Ind AS 36, where we have to compute the recoverable amount. So this standard do not apply. There we have the specific criteria to compute the recoverable amount. So let me go back to the definition. So we said the price that would be received to sell an asset or pay to transfer a liability in an orderly transaction between market participant at a measurement date. So what is orderly transaction? So here the definition says the orderly talks about the orderly transaction. Transaction that assumes exposure to the market for a period before the measurement date to allow the market activities that are usual and customary for the transaction involving such assets or liabilities. So usual transaction or customary transaction, it should not be the forced transactions or under the liquidation or a distress sale. So when a transaction is said not to be orderly, where there is inadequate exposure to the market, where the assets or liabilities marketed to a single participant, so where the transaction happened between only one participant, or there is only one participant in the market, so then it can be said that the transaction is not orderly one. Seller is under insolvency or bankruptcy. He has filed an application, so CIRP application if accepted. So in that case, transaction might not be an orderly one. Or transaction is an outlier. Suppose it is a unique one, and due to some sentiments attached of the buyer or seller, so buyer want to procure or buy that particular item at any price. So in that case, the transaction will not be an orderly one. Then this was fair value, and now measuring the fair value. When measuring the fair value, entity shall take into account the characteristic of assets and liability, the condition and location of assets, restriction if any on the sale, or if there is any restricted item or some restriction attached to it. So in that case, the valuation may be different. So we have to determine the characteristic, condition and location. Suppose I want to sell a car and that car is outside the market, not available in the market. So that I will have to consider that. I'll have to first bring that particular asset to the market, then only I'll be able to sell that asset. Or the condition, if the condition is not fit for sale, so that also I'll have to consider while doing the fair valuation. The fair value measurement assume that the transaction take place in the principal market. So what is principal market? Again, definition said that fair value is the price that we receive to sell an asset or transfer a liability in an orderly transaction between market participants. So market participant should be in the market. So there are two market defined, principal and the most advantageous market. So what is principal market? Let us understand. In case principal market is not there, so we can take the most advantageous market. So principal market is a market where the greatest volume or level of activities of an asset or liability. For example, we have two stock exchange, we have two market, market A and market B, and a particular item is traded in market A at rupees 20 and in market B it is 22. By looking at the price, we will wish to go with market B because market B is giving higher price, but we will have to check the greatest volume and the level of activity. So average trade per day in market A is 2 lakh, in market B is 50,000. So in that case, we will have to take the market A as the principal market because it has the highest volume. So in this case, market A will be the principal market. And in case we have the more or less same trade in both the market, then we will have to choose the most advantageous one. So most advantageous market is which maximizes the amount that would be received to sell an asset or minimize the amount that would be paid to transfer a liability after taking into account the transaction cost and the transportation cost. So now we have to understand what is transaction cost and transportation cost. Transaction is the cost that that is incurred by way of taxes or other levies to enter into that transaction to deal, to complete the deal. And transportation cost is to bring that asset to the market. So in another example, market A, market B, the price is higher in market A, which is 31, market D we have 30. Average trade is more or less same in both the market, and transaction cost we have assumed 3 in market A and 1 in market B, and transportation cost is same in both the markets. So net price would be in market A 23, market B 24. So advantageous market will be market B because after transaction cost and transportation cost, market B has the higher value. So we will take the market B as the most advantageous market. Then determining the fair value, what we have to do? So once we have determined the principal market or the most advantageous market, while measuring the fair value, we should not adjust the transaction cost. Why not transaction cost? Because transaction cost is hypothetical. We are just doing the fair valuation. We are not actually selling or transferring the asset. So transportation cost is in any case we will have to incur to bring that asset to the market. So we will adjust for the transportation cost but not the transaction cost. So in the above example, price in market A was 31, in market B it was 30. Average trade more or less same in both the market, transaction cost 3 and 1, transportation 5 and 5. So most advantageous market would be market B because market B gives the higher price. But for the fair value reporting purpose, we will have to take the 25 as the value. Why? Because we shall not take the transaction cost into account. We will only deduct the transportation cost while computing the fair value. Any questions so far? So I can take. Or shall I move further? Okay. So fair value at initial recognition. Fair value at the time of initial recognition will be the transaction price, which is entry price when I enter into a transaction. So I will recognize it as a the entry price or transaction price as the fair value. Or when the asset is acquired or liability is assumed in exchange, transaction price is the price paid to acquire the asset or receive to assume the liability, entry price. So initial recognition, it would be entry price, or subsequent recognition, it will be exit price. Why? Now the question is why we have to recognize and when we have to recognize assets or liability at fair value. So this standard says that at each reporting date, that is quarterly. So every 3 months we will have to recognize assets or liability at fair value. Not all the assets and liability, I'll talk about that when we come on the disclosure part. Then transaction price might not represent the fair value in some cases. So where the transaction happened between related party, in case the transaction happened between related party, so transaction price might not be the fair value. So in that case, we will have to make a disclosure in our financial statement. When the transaction takes place under duress, or the seller is forced to enter into a transaction due to some covenants. So in that case also, transaction price might not represent the fair value. Or in case of business combination, where the unit of account represented by transaction price is different from the unit of account for asset or liability measured at fair value. For example, in case of a business combination, the entire assets, all the assets and liabilities are acquired, and that may have goodwill included. So I cannot value individual asset because the good without apportioning the goodwill. So the in that case, the transaction price might not represent, because there may be goodwill associated with that. And also in the cases where the transaction happened outside the principal or most advantageous market, so in that case also transaction price might not represent the fair value. Moving further, the valuation premise. So there are number of valuation premise. These are the valuation basis. So some authors have divided into two parts, highest and the best use and going concern. Some have four or five. So these are basically the valuation basis, valuation, or we can say it as a valuation premise. And Ind AS only talks about the highest and the best use. So Ind AS says that we will only consider the highest and the best use of an asset while doing the fair valuation. So even outside Ind AS also, when you do the valuation, you will have to first start with the valuation premise. On that basis only you can do, you would be able to do the valuation. So highest and the best use is that we will presume the highest and the best use of an asset while doing the valuation. For example, let me take an example here of real estate property. So suppose I have a building, and that building is, I can let out that building, but however, I have kept that building idle. Maybe I have a plan to occupy that building in future. So currently I'm not fetching any rent from that building, but while doing the valuation, I will assume that the building, I am getting some rent, notional rent out of that. I'll presume that. So because this would be the highest and the best use. Keeping the building idle is not the highest and the best use, and valuation might be low in that case if I do not presume the notional rent. So I will presume that I'm getting the notional rent, and then on that basis I will value that particular building. Then going concern value, you already all understand. So we believe that our company will go for foreseeable future, and we will consider for the cash flows or revenues for n number of years, and considering that, we will value our business or our asset. As is, where is basis in case of liquidation or in case of sale. So company sell the asset. So in that case, there will be no future benefits that can be considered while doing the valuation. In case of liquidation also, orderly liquidation, in case of sale under the liquidation. So again, the valuation premise change and the value is also different. So highest and the best use will always be higher than the liquidation. Forced transaction in case some litigation or under some restrictions attached to a transaction. So in that case also, the valuation will be less. So these are basically the valuation premise. Moving further, so highest and the best use, as I have explained, fair value measurement of non-financial asset take into account a market participant ability to generate future economic benefit. Whether I am generating their revenues right now or not is not relevant. If the assets can generate economic benefit, so I will have to take into account. That will be the highest and the best use. And the highest and the best use take into account that the use of asset is physically possible. So we took an example of building. So building should not be in a shabby state. So it should be, it can be let out. So it is physically possible. Letting that building out is physically possible, legally permissible. There should not be some court cases going on that building. And it is financially feasible, so that by making minor repairs, I can let out that building easily. For recurring and non-recurring fair value measurement, if the highest and the best use of non-financial assets differ from its current use, the reporting entity shall disclose the fact and why the non-financial asset is being used in a manner that differs from the highest and the best use. So accounting standard here says that in case I am not using particular asset to its highest and the best use, I will have to make a disclosure. For example, in our case, we have not let out that building. And why we have not let out them? Because we have planned to expand in future, and we have to in future we were planning to self-occupy that building. So we all that we will have to report that in our disclosures, in our financial reporting. Then moving further, friends, we have fair value hierarchy. So hierarchy is level 1, level 2, and level 3. So the standard establish a fair value hierarchy 1, 2, and 3 and give the highest priority to the observable inputs, which is level 1, level 2, and level 3 is unobservable input. So level 1 is directly observable without any adjustment. Level 2 is based on the observable inputs, and level 3 is unobservable input, wherein we have used our own methods and own techniques to arrive at the valuation. For example, friends, I am holding the share of Tata Motors, and Tata, somebody else is also holding the share of Tata Motors, and Tata Motors is listing, and it is trading at 320. So we both in our books of accounts value the Tata Motors at the same price, because the data is available in the market. I cannot say that my Tata Motor is 400 and your Tata Motor is 320. So I cannot do that, because the data is available in the market, and I have to use the market. And since the fair value measurement rely upon the market observable data, so the priority order is, first we have to look outside into the market. If the data is not available in the market, then we can use our own methods and techniques. Suppose my company, I'm holding shares of a company which is manufacturing a car, and that company is not listed. but it is of same size of that of Tata Motor. So in that case, what I'll do, the revenue are same of Tata Motors. So I'll take the Tata Motor as a basis, make some adjustment to arrive at the value of my value of the share of my company. And if somebody else is also holding that company's share, he will also do the same thing. He will take the basis maybe of Tata Motors or some other car company into this segment. And he will do the same method arrive at the valuation. And our prices will definitely differ, but there will be not substantial variation. Suppose I valued my company at 300, somebody else holding the same shares, he will not value that at 3000. So there may be difference. I value at 300, he may value at 330. So because the underlying asset, underlying value is market observable. So in that case, we classify that as level 2. Level 2, where the data is not directly market observable. It is, the basis is market observable. And level 3, in case my company is not at all listed and I cannot find market comparable, so I'll use my own techniques or own inputs to arrive at the valuation. So in that case, my valuation will be different from somebody else's valuation. That is why in case of level 3, additional disclosures are required. I hope I made you clear. So moving further, fair value hierarchy, level 1 and level 2. So I made you clear about observable and unobservable inputs. So observable inputs are which are observable, that are developed using the market data, publicly traded information about actual events or transactions. And unobservable inputs, where the market data is not available, that are developed using the information available about the assumption that market participant would use when pricing asset or liabilities. For example, in case the market inputs are not available, I'll use my own approach, maybe DCF approach. So I will derive the future projections and then discount those projections to arrive at the valuation. That will be using the unobservable inputs. Or I may be, if I am using the yield curve or implied volatility, so that may be level 2. So depend upon the case to case basis, if the inputs are observable and some adjustments are there in those observable inputs, then it will be classified as level 2. Otherwise it will be level 3. So level 1, 2, and 3, input used to measure fair value, that are observable, quoted price straight away if company is listed. So straight away that will be level 1. So for identical assets or liability, unadjusted Tata Motors I am holding, I'll take the prices as on the reporting date from the stock exchange. In case volatility, so I will take the weighted average or volume weighted average, and I'll report it as, always report it as level 1. I cannot do some adjustment to the Tata Motor share and arrive at my own value basis their financial statement or their earning release. And I cannot classify Tata Motors as level 2 or 3. I have to classify Tata Motors as level 1. Then level 2 inputs used to measure fair value, which are observable again, but the quoted price in the active market or similar assets or liability. My company is not directly listed, but some of the comparable companies or companies of equal size or equal revenue, equal same segment are listed. So I can take the basis and do the valuation. Or in case of derivatives also, derivatives are mostly classified as level 2. And indirectly observable inputs are yield curve, implied volatility, credit spread, that is coming from the market. So broker quotes, these are coming from directly from the market. So based upon that information, if I am valuing Then friends, moving further to valuation approaches. So valuation approach is a methodology used to determine the fair value of asset or liability. So again, valuation technique should be such that it should maximize the use of observable input and minimize the use of unobservable input. So we will start with the market approach, then we will move on to the income or a cost approach, because market approach directly involves observable inputs. So we have to ensure that the observable inputs, use of observable inputs are maximized. So these are the three approach: market approach, income approach, and cost approach, or we can say it as asset approach. These are on the approach are only three. We can have n number of methods under these approach. For example, market approach, we can devise our own method. We can take the broker quotes, we can take the weighted average, volume weighted average, or we can devise any method to arrive at the valuation basis, the yield curve or implied volatility. Under income approach, this approach quantifies the present value, and this is basically using the unobservable inputs. So future benefits are discounted or capitalized at a discount rate to arrive at the valuation. Under the cost approach, the amount that would be required to replace or reproduce the capacity of an asset. So it is also referred to as current replacement or reproduction cost. So these are basically three approaches. Let us talk about them. Market approach uses the price and other information generated by market transaction involving identical or comparable assets, liabilities, or group of assets or liability. So market approach, I hope I made you understand that if something is derived from the market, maybe not necessarily in case of listed items or listed stock, maybe in case of real estate property, in case I'm getting the transaction from the property registrar, detail of transaction, and averaging out the all the past transaction for 3 months or 6 months. So that will be the, again, the market approach for the real estate valuation. So it uses the market transaction involving identical or comparable. So in case exactly Tata Motors is not listed, or I am holding some other company share which is not listed, so I can use the comparable in that case, or maybe similar company I can find and use the company comparables. So this approach evaluates the value on the basis of prices primarily quoted on the stock exchange. Whatever I am getting from the stock exchange, that is straight away market approach basis, the market valuation. Where the assets has a fewer market comparable or not traded in the active market, valuer may consider using the other valuation approach. So in case you are unable to find any company comparable, or your stock is not listed, you can come to the income approach and do the valuation, or maybe under the cost approach. So under this approach, there are n number of methods: market price method, traded price over a reasonable period in the active market. So we already talked about the principal market. So if something is getting traded frequently, so we can directly take. In case of volatility, we can take weighted average or volume weighted average, guideline company method or comparable company method. Valuing an asset based on market multiple derived from the prices of market comparable traded on active market. Like we said that in case of Tata Motors, in case I'm holding some company share which is also in automobile and which is not listed, so I can take some listed company as the basis. We can take the share of that listed company and make some adjustment to arrive at the value of our own company share, or else we can do the comparable transaction multiple involving the PE multiple, EBITDA multiple. We can use these metrics we can use to arrive at the valuation. Then if we are unable to use the market approach, we can use the income approach. Income approach converts future amount, future cash flows to a single current discounted amount reflecting the current market expectation about the future amount. So DCF, as we all understand, being a chartered accountant, we are well versed with DCF, is a valuation method used to estimate the value of asset based on its future expected cash flows using a discount rate. We are familiar with the DCF method. Income capitalization, again, we capitalize the economic benefits for a representative single period by a capitalization rate. So this was for the, maybe for asset valuation or for intangible assets or for derivative assets, the income approach might not work. So there are some other methods under the income approach, such as relief from royalty, which with or without method, multi-period excess earning method, distributor method. These methods are used for intangible asset valuation. And for derivative valuation, there are again methods, binomial method, Black and Scholes method. I hope Nitish might have covered the Black and Scholes in detail. So then moving further, friends, we have the, so this is the discounted cash flow. So we compute the free cash flow to firm or free cash flow to equity. So this is the formula. I hope you all understand how to compute the DCF. Then terminal value, which is important, so that represents the present value of the explicit forecast period for all the subsequent cash flows to the end of last period, or in case of perpetuity, we will have to compute the terminal value. So, which is important for doing the valuation. And there are other methods also, Gordon growth model for valuation, and variable growth model, exit multiple, salvage and liquidation value. These are other methods used under the income approach. So cost approach, we have the amount that would be required currently to replace the service capacity of an asset. So cost approach, why would we use cost approach? In case we are unable to use the market approach or income approach, we will have to switch to cost approach. For example, in case of in the current scenario where the companies are developing the COVID vaccine, so in this case, company might not have the market comparable or market data available for the valuation of the vaccines, or it's intangible. So they may use, can they use the income approach? No, because the future projections are also uncertain. They cannot predict the future. In this case, they can switch to cost approach. So the amount that they have incurred or they require to replace the capacity. So that is why this cost approach is used to value acquired or internally generated intangibles such as software, technology, or assembled workforce. The cost approach should be used with discretion and generally for intangible assets that are not primary business drivers, for which a market participant may not be willing to pay a significant premium. So two methods are there in the cost approach: reproduction cost method and replacement cost method. So this method involves valuing an asset based on cost that a market participant shall have to incur to recreate the replica of an asset, reproduce that asset. Or replacement cost involves valuing an asset based on the cost that market participant shall have to incur to recreate an asset with the substantially the same utility as that of the asset to be valued. So these are the methods under cost approach. Then once we have arrived at the valuation, friends, we will have to make some adjustment into the valuation, maybe on account of lack of marketability or lack of control. So primarily, these are the two valuation adjustment which is frequently used: discount for lack of marketability and discount for lack of control. And there may be a number of other adjustments such as tax concession, ESOP, and auditor qualification or due diligence, some finding in due diligence, or COVID impact, COVID-19 impact. So we will have to consider that while doing the valuation as well. So discount for lack of marketability is in case I'm holding a big chunk of shares and I may not be able to sell that at one go. So I'll have to discount or bulk discount, we can say, to arrive at the valuation. Discount for lack of control is in case I'm not holding the controllable stake in the company and I will have to first determine the free cash flow to firm and then my share, and then we'll have to adjust for lack of control because I am not holding the controlling stake. Sorry. Then, friends, before moving to disclosure, let me know if you have any questions so far. I would be happy to take any questions. Okay, no questions, friends?
And there are 2-3 questions in the chat box.
Okay, can you please read?
Yeah. The first one is if value in relation to principal market and value on the basis of highest and best use is different, then which one should be considered?
Why can't I open the chat box? Can you please repeat the question?
If value in relation to principal market and value on the basis of highest and best use is different, then which one should be considered?
So that are two different things. Principal market, in case I'm going for the market approach, I'll not use the highest and the best use because highest and the best use is for non-financial assets. Highest and the best use is not for something which is listed on the stock exchange. In case I'm following the market approach, I'll straight away go to the market and take the price. For non-financial assets which are not listed on the stock exchange, I'll have to consider the highest and the best use while making the valuation. I hope that clears.
The second one is asset approach and cost approach. Are they the same?
Yeah, that is same.
One more query is there, but that is referring to a particular slide. So we'll discuss that at the end of the session.
Okay. So that was, friends, we have covered two parts. The first one is fair value and then the fair value measurement. The third section of this accounting standard talks about the disclosure required in the financial statement. So let us talk about the disclosure now. I'll show you the actual disclosure, how I was reporting when I was working with HSBC or General Electric. The level of disclosure required depend upon whether the fair value measurement is recurring or non-recurring. So first of all, we would have to understand what is recurring and non-recurring before we move on with the disclosure. Recurring is something which we have to report at each reporting date at fair value. So in case of listed companies or the companies more than 250 crore of net worth, they are mandatorily required to follow the Ind AS and they have to make the quarterly release of their financial statements. And on every reporting date, they have to do the fair valuation. So they may hire somebody. In case of fair value reporting, there is no as such need of the registered valuer, but they can hire somebody who has a valuation expertise to determine the valuation of their assets or liability, because at each reporting date, they have to do the fair valuation. So that is recurring. For example, if I am having the assets, investment that are classified as trading or that are available for sale. So if those investments are listed in a stock exchange, I can take straight away the market value from the stock exchange. In case of unlisted stock or unlisted assets or liabilities, it will be very difficult to determine the valuation. So in that case, need of professional is there. So company might, in that case, hire somebody or permanently, or will reach out to the professionals like us. So recurring fair value measurement relate to those where the measurement is required at the end of each reporting period. Example is available for sale investment, where we have to do the mark to market and we have to put the mark to market under OCI. So fair value through OCI, and we have to, at each reporting date, we have to do the fair valuation. Non-recurring fair value measurement means a valuation is to be done when something has happened, some event has occurred, or some transaction has happened, and that may be the change in the classification. Something I have classified as held for sale, which I do not want to hold, and I have classified some asset or liability as held for sale because I do not have intention to carry and I want to dispose of. So in that case also, I'll have to do the fair valuation, and at each reporting date, I'll have to do the fair valuation. Or in case of impairment also, once something is impaired, so in that case also, I'll have to do the fair valuation at each reporting date. So that is non-recurring, based upon some event, either due to impairment or change in the classification, something has happened. That is why I'm required to report that particular asset or liability at fair value. Otherwise, all the financial instruments, FAS 109 talks about that. So, Ind AS 109 talks about that. So, in case of financial instrument, we will have to compulsorily fair value that, whether it is derivative or other financial instrument, we will have to compulsorily fair value at each reporting date. Now, friends, how fair value reporting got developed, before I show you the disclosure and we go into deep into the disclosure. So let me give you a background about how fair value reporting developed. So before the subprime crisis in US, historically, the balance sheets were, if you look at the left hand side of your screen, so historical balance sheets, when we had investment standards in Indian accounting standard. So it was like investment, we will have to classify that investment, and under notes to accounts, we give the breakout of those investment in company A, B, C, D, S, like that. So this was what historically been done. And the fair value hierarchy developed through FAS 157 in US. So they felt the need that the company should classify the investments, their investment, into level 1, 2, and 3 based upon the observable or unobservable data. So initially they developed this hierarchy. And later on, what companies were doing, companies were showing most of their as investments into level 3 category. So then regulators required additional detail, and they asked for this activity of level 3. Level 3 activity, which is called level 3 roll forward. So from the opening balance till the closing balance, they asked for the level 3 roll forward. And the company started showing the level 3 roll forward. In 2011 in US, they came up with an update, and which asked for additional detail for the level 3 items, which is valuation technique, which valuation technique have you used to arrive at this valuation, what are the unobservable inputs you have used, range, tell us the range of that input, the weighted average of, and the sensitivity analysis in case of change in the input, where will the valuation go. So, sorry. So this is how it developed gradually, starting 2008 till 2012-13, and later on IFRS adopted, and through IFRS 13 and in India, Ind AS 113. And there are a couple of periods, reporting period, I think, annual reporting period, which has ended for the Ind AS 113. So now, coming to the disclosure, so what we need: assets and liabilities recorded at fair value on recurring basis, which is fair value hierarchy. We already talked about that fair value hierarchy, level 1, level 2, and level 3. We are also required to report the transfers between level 1 and level 2. So regulator also want to know that why level 1 earlier has now become level 2. Why level 2 now has become level 1. So has that company got listed? Is that the reason why you are recognizing it as level 1 now? And why have you recognized, if that is not the reason, why have you recognized it level 2 earlier? Was that a mistake? So transfer between level 1 and level 2, they wanted to know. Reason for those transfer also. And for the level 3, especially items, because that uses the unobservable input, they require the reconciliation from the opening balance to the closing balance, description of valuation technique and input used, change in the valuation technique, any reason for making such change. So in case you are using particular valuation technique and now you have changed in subsequent quarter, so why you have changed, was that particular technique not appropriate? So kind of question you will have to answer in your financial reporting document. Narrative description of a sensitivity of the fair value measurement to changes in unobservable inputs. If the change in those inputs to different amount might result in significantly higher or lower fair value measurement. So what will be the impact on the change in the input used to the fair valuation? And again, the significant transfers into level 3 or out of level 3. So in case from level 2, something has moved to level 3. So you will have to report that. Something moving out of level 3 to level 2, you will have to report that. Asset or liability recorded in the fair value on non-recurring basis. So again, for non-recurring also, we will have to report the fair value hierarchy, unobservable inputs used for the non-recurring also. Additional disclosure about fair value financial instruments that are not carried at fair value. So for financial instrument which are not carried at fair value, like the securities which are HTM securities, held to maturity, we do not carry that security at fair value yet. We have to report that, the fair value for that particular security. So that is also required over and above this hierarchy. So more or less, we will have to disclose the fair value hierarchy or fair value for all the assets and liabilities, for most of the, I can say, assets and liabilities in the balance sheet. So friends, this is the table I have shown where the disclosure requirement for recurring and non-recurring. You can go through that table later. And let me show you the disclosure in the financial statement of HSBC Bank. So this is the fair value measurement disclosure. Let me first show you the balance sheet so that will be easier for you to relate. Friends, this is the annual report from the HSBC Bank. So this is the a statement of income, then we have the other comprehensive income, investment security, mark to market goes to OCI. This is the balance sheet. So this is the balance sheet and these are the balances. Most of the balances we have reported at fair value. Some of the balances are not at fair value. I'll show you. And these are the notes to accounts, and we are moving to the fair value measurement. So this is the note to account for fair value measurement. So we talked about the fair value adjustment, we talked about fair value hierarchy, and this is the fair value hierarchy. Assets and liabilities recorded at fair value on recurring basis. Recurring basis are those which we have to compulsorily report at fair value. So at each reporting date, we have to fair value these assets or liabilities. So these are all assets, and this is level 1, level 2, level 3. Netting is there in US. You will not find netting in IFRS. If you look at the IFRS financial statement, netting is not done. That is reported net off. So there is derivative netting in case of US GAAP. So this is how we report the fair value measurement for recurring basis, right? Level 1, 2, and 3 for all the assets which are required to be reported at fair value. And for the corresponding previous year also. Then we have the information on level 3 assets or liabilities. As we discussed, for level 3 assets or liabilities, we have to give the reconciliation of opening and closing balance. So for level 3, if you look at the collateralized debt obligation, it is 100 at the start and ending balance is nil. So let me take something else which has a balance. So let's take student loan, asset-backed security. 92, it started, and again that. So let us take CDOs. 1803 corporate and domestic debt securities, and 510 was the closing balance. So let's go. Corporate and other debt securities. 1803, level 3. We will have to report the roll forward only for level 3 items. So 1803 is the opening balance and 510 is the closing balance. 1803 is the opening, 510 is the closing. So what all activities, maybe by account of earning, purchase, issuance, settlements, or transfer in and out of level 3, we have to report that. So this, in this case, in case of student loan, it started from 92 and 17 million settlement happened and then transferred out of level 3. Maybe they may have classified it as level 2. Let us check if they have classified as level 2. So student, yes, it is. So out of level 3, it has moved to level 2. Earlier, it was level 3. So this is how we have to report the roll forward for level 3 items, right? For all the assets and liabilities which are in level 3 under this hierarchy table. So again, for the corresponding period also, we have to report this hierarchy. And significant unobservable inputs for recurring fair value measurement for level 3 items, corporate and other domestic debt securities were 510. So we will have to report the valuation technique, which valuation technique we have used. sorry. So which valuation techniques we have used to arrive at the valuation? So here we have used the discounted cash flows. So for corporate and other domestic debt securities, we use the discounted cash flow. So we have to report that. In case not the discounted cash flow, then what techniques, whether that is option pricing model or whether that is based on the broker quotes or some volatility, implied volatility, whatever it is. So we'll have to report that. And the inputs we have used, significant unobservable inputs. So we have used the spread volatility, correlation between insurance claim. So this we have to report that, and we have to report the range of inputs. Suppose this is not the only one item, we have to report the range of input from this particular percentage. Suppose under 510 we have 100 items. So I might not use single rate for all those items. So what is the range of input used? For example, for some items I have used 6%, or some items I have used on the higher side at 18%. So 6 to 18 would be the range. And what would be the weighted average? I'll have to disclose that also. So here weighted average is not applicable because this is the only single item in this case. In another case, if you look at the equity derivative, we have used option pricing model, so equity index volatility or dividend yield. Then we have the ranges and we have the weighted average also. And this similarly for the corresponding period, we have to report. Then transfer in and out of level 3, we talked about why transfer happened and all. Then the second part is for non-recurring assets and liabilities which happened valued on fair value on happening of some event. So residential mortgage classification to held for sale, so that has triggered. So we will have to again do the fair value hierarchy for non-recurring piece, for loans, impaired assets also. So we did level 1, 2 and 3. So non-recurring generally do not have level 1. They may also have, because all the financial instrument, in any case, we will have to do the fair valuation regularly. In case of a non-recurring, you will generally find level 2 and level 3. So level 3, again, we will have to give the details, activity of level 3, and then additional detail, which is valuation technique used, significant unobservable inputs, ranges and weighted average and all. So this is how the fair value reporting is done. Then finally, the additional disclosure for fair value of financial instrument that are not carried at fair value. For example, in case of a banking company, loans are not required to carry at fair value unless that are impaired. So in that case, loan are carried at LOCOM, loan are carried at cost, and the fair valuation is to be done, but in the books it is not recorded. So this is additional disclosure where the assets are carried at fair value, carried at their carrying value, but additional disclosure which is fair value and its leveling we have to report. And similarly for corresponding period. So this was all about the disclosure. I hope I made you clear. Coming back to the presentation. So we have covered, friends, all the three sections, fair value, from where we have started with fair value definition, what is fair value, framework for establishing the fair value. We have talked about the approaches, and we also talked about the disclosure required for the financial reporting purposes. Then finally, I have the COVID-19 impact on fair value measurement. So what would be the impact of COVID-19? So this is already the past companies have already reported in their financial statements the COVID impact. So let me quickly discuss the COVID impact. So COVID-19 has affected the classification into hierarchy, because during the lockdown period, markets were not operational. Some of the stocks were not getting traded, or there were very less trades. So we, in that case, it was difficult to classify those securities as level one, because valuers were unable to find the broker quotes, or valuer were unable to find the volumes. So unable to identify the principal markets. So in that case, it had become difficult. Now it is fine. But during that time, it was difficult to classify the assets or liabilities into fair value hierarchy. So there were a lot of movement between the hierarchy, class changes in the classification. And there were a number of adjustments which were made to the observable data, because there were uncertainty all across, and observable data were not reliable. So companies made a lot of adjustment. And since observable data was not available, so unobservable data were used, and companies used their own approach or on multiples or on techniques to arrive at the valuation. So level two classification were moved to level three, because the underlying items were not getting traded, and the sources were not available during the lockdown, or companies were forced to quit the market. So there were transactions which were under the distress. So the valuation was become a bit difficult during the COVID period. Nowadays also, because it is very difficult to predict the future using the income approach, we cannot rely on the management projection. So it has really become a challenge to do the valuation. So challenges in fair value assessment, issue in forecasting, cash flows, as I said. So cash flows, it is very difficult to predict the cash flows due to uncertainty. COVID is again emerging. So for the next couple of years, cannot clearly project the cash flows. Which valuation method should I go with? Again, it is at this time, particularly during COVID, it is very difficult to assess. Impact of assumption on discount rate or credit spread. Again, the market is volatile. Due to fear, the market suddenly, despite the intrinsic value of the company, strong intrinsic value, market, due to market sentiments or due to fear, the market prices fell suddenly. So that is what all happening. And again, it is the assumptions which we used to take in normal scenario, it is quite difficult. Comparable data is not available, or it is not authentic, or we cannot easily rely on or dormant stocks. Some of the companies are planning to delist, or some other are planning to file the insolvency. So again, a challenging time. Difficulty in making the adjustment also, because marketability is not available. It is not the buyer-driven market. It is seller-driven market. Difficulty assessing the COVID relief impact. So government has given the some kind of concession or interest waiver. So that will also be taken into account while doing the valuation. That's all, friends, I have for today. I hope I made you clear about fair value measurement. So I am open for the question now. Nitish?
Yeah. Thank you, Karan. That was a wonderful session. Now I request all the participants to raise any question if they have. There is a question in the chat box. Under what situation discount for control to be added or reduced?
When you have a particular stock, suppose you have more than 25% investment, you are an associate. So in that case, or in case you have more than 50% holding. So in that case, the scenario will be different. In case you are holding only 1% share, so you will not have any say in the organization. You will be just holding, and whatever the management will distributing, you will be getting. So in that case, you will have to discount your stock. In the other case where you have more than 20% shareholding, where you are associate, you will have some say in the organization where you have holding position. So you will be driving the decision. So in that case, if you are holding small portion, you will have to discount.
Right. There is one more query that is relating to transaction and transportation cost.
Okay.
So it is referring to a particular slide which is not mentioned here. You just explain what is the difference between the same transaction.
Transaction cost. Okay, I'll make you clear. Transaction cost is something which you have to pay by way of taxes or to incur to the broker, or that is transaction. If you complete the transaction, you will have to pay some commission or some taxes or some levies. Transportation cost is something you will have to for a non-financial asset, especially something lying somewhere and you have to bring that asset to the market. Suppose you have a car that is lying in Hyderabad and you want to, that car is of Delhi number and you have to sell that in Delhi. So first of all, you will have to bring that particular car to Delhi, then only you will be able to sell. So that is the transportation cost. Why we are not considering the transaction cost in valuation? Because we are just doing the valuation. We are not actually selling our asset. We are just, for the financial reporting purpose, we are just doing the fair valuation of our asset. And the transportation cost is relevant because without the transportation cost, we will not be, in any case, we will not be able to sell our asset. For determining the most advantageous market, we will take into account both the transportation and transaction cost. Once the market is determined, while doing the fair valuation, we will take into account only the transportation cost, not the transaction cost.
Right. If I request participants to raise any query if they have, they can raise their hand or unmute themselves, or they can write it in the chat box as well. The PPT for the session as well as the video recording will be shared in the group. So I don't think, Karun, there is any other query.
Okay. Okay.
So we thank you. Thank you very much for a wonderful deliberation on India's 113. It was really an insightful session, and I hope all the participants must have enjoyed the same. You are getting a feedback as well in the chat box that is very, very nicely explained the concepts of India's 113. And thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Nitiji. Thank you all.
We'll take your guidance in the future as well for various other sessions.
Yeah, sure, Nitish. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, bye.
I am ending the session now. Thank you, everyone.